Start back in the beginning.
Yes, sir. After the welcome. Okay. Okay. Could you do in between the plate passing song and the choir special? Because I got to go back and sit at the piano. If you can do a thing right there. It was. Oakville, how are you all doing? You looking good? It's been a while. It's been a while. You all glad you're here? Do any of you remember many years ago a guy wrote a country song and he said it was the perfect country song? And it had a mom and a train and a truck and that. You are possibly at the perfect blended service this morning. We're going to have contemporary music, traditional, choruses, hymns, gospel, African spiritual, a song written straight for this service. But one thing we don't have is rap. I'm sorry, we don't have rap, but instead, we're going to have a responsive reading. So please stand. And we're going to start with a responsive reading. So, follow along on the congregation part. I'll sing the leader part, Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day.
Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples.
Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, O families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts.
Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth.
Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity.
Amen. And now, if you would, continue as we sing, Come, Now is the Time to Worship.
Oh,
everybody.
Hi.
I surprised him. How's everybody doing this morning? Not a bad morning, huh? We're here. That's all right. I wonder if I could ask you to do something this morning. I wonder if you might just bow your head and say your own prayer. Needs that you have, blessings you want to thank our Father for, petitions that you may have on your mind. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Come to you, Father, this morning, thanking you for all the blessings that we have, for all good things are from above, and we know that because you've told us that in your future, in your scriptures. Father, help us to do your will in our personal lives, in our families, at work, among our friends, and in this community. Be with our pastor as he presents the message to us this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Please remain standing. On behalf of First Baptist Church of Oakville, I'd like to welcome every one of you, especially if you're visiting with us. Also those that might be watching online and at home because of the weather or whatever. So glad to have you joining us as well. If you are here, if you're a visitor for the first time, if you would take the time to fill out this flap on the bulletin, tear it off and put it on the plate as it's passed later so we can have a record of your visit. And also, is there a prayer need or something, if you want to put that on there so that we can have and tend to that as well. So if you don't know anything about us, we love God, we love each other, and we love you. And if you might have forgotten, I'm not sure, we weren't here last week. We are the
friendliest church.
And we like to show each other by welcoming each other. We've got a song that we sing, and this one this morning we're going to be doing Cornerstone. So greet those around as we sing. Be seated.
All right. I have to confess, I came in this morning and I looked around and I thought, oh no, the winter weather has hurt us, because I saw several empty seats. And then I looked up in the choir and I knew why. So glad to have y'all back up there for a while this morning. Looking forward to hearing from you later. I got one of these this morning from our boys and girls. Did some of you get one too? I tell you what, Mike and Diane do some really creative things with their kids, and I just genuinely appreciated that thoughtfulness stuff. Diane, thank you, and pass along to the kids. And I tell you what, it's not cheap chocolate either. That's Dove. That's good stuff. The Townsends are not here today. They are in Colorado enjoying, I think, 40-some inches of snow. Couldn't happen to nicer people. God willing, they'll be coming back Tuesday. But in their absence, we do have a couple of folks that have something they'd like to share with us. And so I'm going to ask my wife to come first. And she wants to share something with the ladies, I assume. Maybe for guys, too. Can be. I understand. And then Lisa Muser is going to come and share with us. Lisa, come on down if you want to, so, and you'll be next. All right. Here we go. There you are.
You want to be my banner?
I will.
He's my banner. Thursday night, the Women's Ministry Committee is sponsoring again the second time that we can, well, pick up a paintbrush and act like we know how to paint. And you don't have to, because some of the 15 that have already signed up said they've never picked up a paintbrush. No. It's the verse on here, if you can't see it from the back, says, "The Lord will fight for you. You need only be still." I love that verse. It's a super simple project. The lady that will be leading it, her name is Gloria Stignorino. She's a personal friend. She's an artist. You better behave. Vanna doesn't do this. Anyway, it's at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall. You've got until this evening to decide if you haven't signed up. We have 15 so far that have signed up, and we do have room for a few more to join us. It's $25. Bring your $25 or your check payable to Gloria that night here at church at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall for a couple of hours, and we will have fun. And don't worry if you've never painted before, because there's a lot that haven't. And they said, well, I don't know how to do this. This is simple, and she will be able to help us. So just let us know by this evening if you want to join us Thursday.
And I can testify that it is simple, because I've done it, and I don't have a creative bone in my body. The bulletin has the insert for our book club. I'm pleased to say that we've done it twice so far in the past month, and we've had 7 people, which is a nice group. But if there's anybody out there that wants to participate in the next round, I'll be picking up the book from the book kit from the library the 1st of March. We'll meet sometime in May. And then, of course, I'll return the books to the library, which, again, is a point I want to make. You don't have to buy the book. I do get the book kits from the St. Louis County Library. We're allowed to keep them for 8 weeks, and then I return the books. And so we meet in my home for roughly an hour or so. We discuss the book, we solve all the world's problems, and we eat cake and ice cream all in about an hour and 15 minutes. So it's fun time. So if anybody wants to participate, fill out the insert, and I guess either put it in the offering plate or hand it to me. You know, that's fine. One other thing I just wanted to say real quick has nothing to do with the book club. There's an initiative out there for a merger with St. Louis County, merging St. Louis City with St. Louis County. It's still in the early stages. I would urge you to do research and find out what it's all about, so that you can decide which side of the fence you want to be on, whether you want to before the merger or against the merger. It's possible that it will go to a statewide vote where people in Springfield and Joplin and everything would determine the fate of this merger with the city and county. I'm not telling you what side to be on. I'm just very urgently asking you to do the research so that you are well informed of the implications if this should happen, implications for us as county residents being joined with the city. So that's it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Lisa. And it is our responsibility to vote. Therefore, it is also our responsibility to be informed on the issues that we're voting about. So I appreciate that word. And I have not been to the book club, but I can testify the cake is very good. So I will give witness to that. So be a what? All right. Oh, okay. I confess I was standing here wondering which parts of the butterfly you were going to use. So, okay. All right. Thank you, ladies. Thank you. Johnny, God bless.
All right. You guys ready to worship? I better try that again. You guys ready to worship? In song, anyway? Yeah. So good. This young, dapper young man here, I don't know if you guys remember or not, he's back. This is Cody Parks. And so good to have him back. And playing some brass this morning.
Last time he didn't have facial hair.
He didn't, yeah. No. But he's
got a little bit right now.
So join us as we sing Praise to the Father.
Praise that wonderful name of Jesus.
wonderful name of Jesus. Hear that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. Something about that name. Please stand as we sing our offertory hymn, 141 in your hymnals. Great classic traditional gospel song, The Old Rugged Cross.
Thank you.
As we prepare to worship the Lord in the giving of our tithes and offerings this morning, the expression of our gratitude to Him for what He has given to us, let's go to Him together in prayer. Wayne Allen, would you word our prayer, please, sir?
Heavenly Father, we thank You for this time to come together, a chance to reacquaint ourselves with each other and to worship You in this house. We thank You for all the gifts You've given us through our lives, with friends and family, and gifts of all natures. We ask now that You accept these gifts and return to You to do work in Your name. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Glad to have you up there with them this morning. Good to have you back. Let me take just a couple of minutes and share some things with you. Officer Mings, good to see you today. Chris called me last Sunday. Chris called me last Sunday and said, I won't be able to be there today, and I don't think you will either. He had worked the evening or the night shift, and he told me they were up to 40-some wrecks that they had already worked in that shift, and he was going to have to work over. So obviously we didn't have services last Sunday. And let me mention something just quickly in passing. Went to visit Jim and Margie Robbins this week, and I'll say a little more about that in a moment. But while we were there, Margie handed me an envelope, and she said, I thought I would bring this to church, but I haven't been able to. Will you take it for me? And they were simply making up their offering for the weeks that they had missed. And so I would only pass along to you, as you think about the Sundays we've had to miss. We started this year with a comfortable surplus, but two Sundays that we weren't able to meet has eaten into it significantly. So that's in the for what it's worth category to be thinking about. I appreciate your faithfulness so much, but thought about Jim and Margie. We did go to see them this week, and as most of you now are aware, Jim Robbins is in hospice care, which means the doctors say there's nothing more they can do to help him. And so we really need to be in prayer for Jim. He's weakened, but he is still able to have visitors and have company. So if you have time to call or go by, I know they would appreciate it. Just let them know you're thinking of them and keep them in your prayers. Obviously, this is a difficult time for Jim and Margie both, as you can appreciate. Larry Barker and his wife, Donna, were down at Dexter, Missouri, down in that area this week. And Larry, again, pass along to Donna our prayer thoughts as she was there for the funeral of her brother. And so we pray for them in that loss. Betty Dohack called me last night and told me that Kevin is going to have surgery Tuesday to repair the fistula. He's still having numbness in his arm. And so we want to be in prayer for him. So Betty, pass that along for us, if you will. And Walter, you were telling me you got an MRI this tomorrow. So we'll be praying with you about that. We have a young couple back here that's visiting with us, and it was difficult to hear each other when we were singing, but got to meet them. We're really glad you came and welcome today. And we have a brand new person with us today. And so, Sarah, if you can you stand and let us welcome Brendan Southard Jr.? All right. He is God's blessing. I know he is the fruit of your love, but he is also the answer to our prayers. And we are most grateful that he's here and able to be with you and that y'all are able to be back. So welcome this morning. We have a couple others. Let me real quickly mention, and then the choir is going to sing for us. And Johnny had asked me if I would take just a few moments this morning. I'm probably taking more than I should have. But anyway, wanted to mention to you that Larry Lauer is still in rehab out at the Woodlands in Arnold, and he is making some progress, but it's been a long month, in fact, literally a month, since he had that back surgery. So let's continue in prayer for him. And you see there are a number of others on our list that are dependent upon us to pray for them. And so in each of our worship services, we try to pause, and we do now, to ask you to intercede for the folks. If you want to, just even have your bulletin in front of you. And as your eyes scan that list of names, let your heart reach out to God in their behalf. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you now, and we pause in our worship, our celebration, our fellowship, to appeal to you as an all-powerful God and our loving Heavenly Father, that there are people whom we love that we know you love also who have needs. Some are sorrowful with aches in their hearts. Some are sick with aches in their bodies. But in each case, they have a need. And we are confident of your ability to meet that need in your power and by your grace. And so we pray, Father, that you would indeed reach out to each of these, to reach them, to help them, to bless them. Bless us as we continue to worship you. Bless the choir as they give their testimony in song. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
This song is a fun little song, and I hope you enjoy it. But from the theological standpoint, did I say that right, Pastor?
So far.
We as Christians have a hope that one day, when we're not here, we're with him.
Amen.
And that's what this is, whether you agree with full theology of it or not, I don't care. But we're going to have a good time singing it, and you all please just enjoy the song. And if you want to clap along with us, we got a drummer on this one, by the way. So we're going to, goodbye world, goodbye.
That was good. What do you want me to say?
Give us an A. Haven't had one in a long time.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, well, I'm willing to wait my turn. All right. Busy morning. All right. Can I move your, Ernie, I'm going to move your guitar back a little bit. All right. Okay. It's not that I mind this stuff being up here, I just don't want to hit anything. All right. As we continue this series of messages, over the last several weeks, unfortunately interrupted by weather twice.
PJ, your mic's not on.
Oh, thank you. All right, is that better? Appreciate that. Okay. As I said, when I was so rudely interrupted... Thank you, Rhonda. Okay, with the interruption, I want to take just a few moments and review this topic that we've been sharing with you, and we will for the next several weeks. It's entitled Living the Christian Life Abundantly. And I suspect that if I took a poll of this room, probably 90%, 95% of us are Christians, assured we're Christians, and by the way, would have had no problem with the theology of that song. Okay? But the problem is that oftentimes people who live the Christian life, sometimes for many years, fail to live it and experience the abundance that Jesus told his disciples he wanted them to have. And that means that for us as Christians, we may well be living beneath our privilege as the children of God. And so I have shared with you the Greek word perisson. Coming from John chapter 10 and verse 10, Jesus said to his disciples, I am come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And I leave it to you to determine, is my Christian life one that I can call abundant? And so over the next several weeks, and as we've tried to do, to share some thoughts that may encourage you and help you as you think about your relationship with Jesus Christ, and about your own Christian experience. And so, we just to kind of help us know where we're going, we've been talking about life in Christ, and we'll do that again today. What is that? And then we'll go to growing in Christ. Why is it? And finally, our confidence in Christ. How is it? And so, that's over the next several weeks. But we've talked about life in Christ, and first we shared with you a month ago that it is salvation, and then 2 weeks ago, we talked about Christian assurance. Today, I want to share with you about preparation and provision. But first, let's lay that foundation again. What does it mean to be saved or to have life in Christ? It means to have a faith relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. Now, you may say, well, I already knew that. Sometimes we know it, but we don't know it. See? Or sometimes we know it, but we haven't verbalized it to ourselves, okay? It is not what you do for Christ that determines whether you're a Christian. It's what you do with Christ. That's the difference, okay? Now, how does one become saved? Or how does one begin life in Christ? And by the way, life in Christ is not in heaven. It starts right here. Someone said, it's not for the sweet by and by, it's for the nasty here and now. By inviting Jesus Christ into your life, the abundant life that Jesus promised to his disciples is available to us now. It is not something we have to wait till we die to receive. It is not a future inheritance. It is a present promise. Important to remember that. Okay, here's one other thing that a lot of folks lose. if you talk with somebody and you ask them about their salvation, they may tell you about something that happened 8, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 50 years ago, when they were at a summer camp or in Bible school or in a revival. Or, you know, we all have a different testimony about where we began our relationship with Christ. The point is, we think of salvation as an event. And I've often heard folks say, I was saved when, see. But salvation is not an event in our past. It's a process in our present. It began for me when I was 7 years old, when I received Jesus Christ as my Savior. But that didn't complete it. That didn't end it. It's been going on ever since. And guess what? It's not done yet. Because as Paul reminds us, there is a present day dimension, but there also, as our choir so beautifully reminded us a while ago, is a future dimension to what life in Christ is supposed to be and the abundance that we're supposed to have. But there's also about assurance. And from time to time, I'll hear people ask me, how do you know you're saved? Some years ago, one of our well-known evangelists in Southern Baptist life went across the country preaching, if you can't point to an exact time and place where you invited Jesus Christ into your life, you're probably not saved. And he went on to add, if you've ever doubted your salvation, it means you're not really saved. Hear me. If you have never doubted the promise of God of your salvation, you're not human. See? Because the promise of God is so incredible that by simply expressing and receiving Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, accepting his forgiveness for our sin gained on the cross, and that I can go to heaven for all eternity. Some folks just honestly say, I can't believe that. See? Humanly, it is natural for us to question it. But it doesn't mean we don't have it. It just means in our humanity, we're uncertain. But God wants us to be sure of our salvation. He wants us to know that we have assurance in him. And so 2 weeks ago, we talked about the assurance of the Holy Spirit, who Paul says seals us and marks us as we are God's, not just by possession, but we are God's by relationship. And then over in 1 John, John wrote, these things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. If you're here this morning and you're a Christian and you're not sure whether you're going to heaven or not, you've missed something very important about your salvation. God's word is clear, God's word is absolute, and God's word is resolute. If Jesus Christ is your Savior, two things are true. Number one, you can't lose the salvation that he's given you. And number two, you will go to heaven when you die. Your salvation is complete. And here's the assurance he gives us. First, understand that salvation is a gift from God, not an achievement of our works. You're not going to heaven because you're here in church today. You're going to heaven because of your faith in Jesus Christ. Being here in church today simply gives you an opportunity to affirm that, to celebrate that, and hopefully to share that with other people. And the second thing to remember is salvation is a changed nature, not just changed conduct. Boy, I wish I had $100 for every time through the years I've heard somebody say, preacher, I'm going to clean up my act and go to church. They've got the cart before the horse, see? I'm going to get close to God, and God will help me clean up my act. See, instead of me trying to do it on my own. God doesn't look for reformed characters. He looks for characters who need reform. And so it's important to understand, when I received Jesus Christ as my Savior, I became a different person than I was before. I may have looked alike. I may have acted the same, unfortunately, but I'm different. And that difference is irreversible. Amen. Okay? Amen. Finally, salvation is a divine promise of everlasting life. The first time God ever said oops to a Christian and they lost their salvation, it's not everlasting. There's only one definition for everlasting, and that's forever. And that's the promise that we have. Okay, with that quick review, Let's talk about preparation and provision. And the choir sang about the glories of heaven, okay? Goodbye, world, goodbye. So I have a question for you. Why are we still here? Now think about this. If heaven is such a beautiful place, and it's assured that I will be there, and I'm at that point, I remember my mother some years ago saying, you know, I'm looking forward to heaven. Because now that she was in her 80s, I have more people over there than I have left over here. See, I'm beginning to understand what she meant. See, and when we think about the reunion that we talk about and when we sing about the glories of heaven, why are we still here? Why didn't God, when he saved us, just take us to heaven? You remember me telling you about Todd Taylor, Brenda's pastor that married us years ago? I've forgiven him. I just like to see if you're listening. Don't get excited. Todd always told when he was pastoring a little church down in southern Illinois, they'd have two revivals a year. And they had one old rascal in that town that every year he would just create havoc all over town. Lying, cheating people, just gossiping, just the worst kind of a person. And lo and behold, he'd come to the revival. And he'd come down and tearfully rededicate his life. And all the church would welcome him and celebrate and pray for him. And then he'd go out and start doing exactly the same thing again for six more months. And when the next revival came, guess what? He'd come back and rededicate his life. And Todd said, you know, I decided one day the next time he comes and rededicates his life, I'm going to shoot him right there at the altar so he can go to heaven clean. See, you know, instead of all this back and forth, in and out, wishy-washy stuff. Well, here's the thing. If heaven is such a beautiful place, a promise of God, why am I still here? Why didn't he just take me home when he saved me? He could have. See, I'm his. He can take me anytime he wants me. So when we think about preparation, the thing to understand is God is preparing us for fellowship with him. You remember, the whole point of salvation is God wants relationship with us. The point of salvation is not that God wants to change our behavior. God wants to change our nature. He wants fellowship with us. But you know what? The way I am right now, I'm not going to be worth a whole lot for fellowship with God for the rest of eternity. Now, ask yourself honestly, would you like to spend forever being just like you are right now? Okay? Some of you have heard me say it, and I believe it. When I get to heaven, I'm going to be 6'6", and my nickname's going to be Slim. And, you know, that's God's promise. That's going to be better than this, but I'm not there yet. And we refer to this process of continuing to be saved as sanctification. God is working in us to prepare us for heaven with him. Notice, heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. And I say that because of what Jesus said in John chapter 14, I go to prepare a place for you. Let's read it together. Do not let your heart be troubled, Jesus said. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. It's been over 50 years ago, but I remember having to do my first funeral. Older man, deacon in our church, he died. His wife didn't come to church, and I really did not meet her until I had received the call about his death and went to visit in their home. And as we sat together and as we talked about the memorial service and what she would like to have done. And then I just asked her, really out of courtesy, not because I knew what to do, but I just asked her, any other questions? And she said, yes, where's heaven? I was 18 years old, freshman in college, pastoring my first church, doing my first funeral. I'd think about that one. Where's heaven? I came back to her that evening, and I said, you know, I've thought about your question, and I'd like to suggest to you that heaven is where Jesus is. Amen. I've been in the ministry 52 years. Unfortunately, I've had to do a whole lot of funerals since then. The honest truth is, I haven't come up with a better answer yet. See, Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you so that you will be there with me. What's going on in your life right now is God is preparing you for fellowship with him. He's preparing you so that you will enjoy heaven as much as he will enjoy you. Think about it. He went on to say, and you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, I always could identify with Thomas, you know, being a little impetuous. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, so how do we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Jesus desires that through him we would come to God. I cannot draw you a complete picture of heaven, but on the testimony that Jesus gave in John 14, I can tell you where heaven is. See? And I can tell you how assured heaven is. Now, Paul says it this way, for we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. He was talking to the church at Corinth, and these young Christians at Corinth, they were troubled about life and death and how death fits into the plan of God. So he went on, he says, for indeed in this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven, insomuch as we, having put it on, will not be found naked. Brenda and I were with Danae and Kent and Chris yesterday, enjoyed being with them for a little while. We'd gone into a little show, kind of an expo, and we walked around quite a bit, you know. When we walk around quite a bit, we're getting to the point where, you know, after a while, it's not so much fun. And anyway, we go out to get in the car, and it was funny. She opened her door, I opened mine, we got in the car, and we both groaned at the same time. You know, I mean, that just lets you know that we're suited for each other, because we're getting to the same place at the same time, that stuff just hurts, okay? Paul says, we groan. That's just a part of our lives and getting older. But, he says, we don't want to be found unclothed, that is, disembodied. And so he goes on to say, for indeed, while we are in this tent, this body, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that what is mortal, that is, what can die, will be swallowed up by life, what can't. Now, he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a pledge. I've sometimes likened death to the cocoon of a worm. You know, a worm goes through that stage of its life. It forms a cocoon. When it comes out of the cocoon, it's a butterfly. See? Now, I could imagine, if I were a worm, and I know for some of you that's not hard to imagine either, that we just forego the cocoon. See? We can't do that. Death for a Christian is like a cocoon to a butterfly. It is that point at which we make the transition from what we were to what we're intended to be. And so Paul says, and he draws on his own experience as a tent maker, he says, this body's like a tent. This body was never made to be permanent. It was made to be temporary. And as you know from experience, some are more temporary than others. But none of us live forever. And Paul says that's God's plan, that this physical body, which is limited, which is restrained, which wears out, will be put away and replaced with a body that's suitable for heaven. So God is not only preparing me for heaven, he's preparing heaven for me as well. Now, that's preparation. And so whatever's going on in your life right now, think about it this way, that God is using your experiences to help you be ready for heaven. But there's also provision. I ask the question, why are we still here? Why didn't God just take us on to heaven? Because it's such a wonderful and beautiful place. Because he's working on us. He's got some things to do to prepare us for that prepared place. But then provision, the question, why did God leave us here? And here's why. The best hope for someone else's salvation is us. Think about this for a moment. The plan A of God's provision of grace for every person is another person. I suspect if you think about it for just a moment, every one of you can point to someone, a parent, a preacher, a teacher, a friend, someone that God used to introduce you to Jesus Christ. That point person, if you please, that one who, among all others who may have cared or concerned or prayed, there was one who brought it to you in such a way, and God laid it upon your heart, and you said yes. That's why God leaves us here. God wants me to go to heaven, but he doesn't want me to go all by myself. See, when I get there, he wants it to be a time of reunion with those that are there because I was here. Some years ago, when I retired at South County Baptist Church, boy, that didn't stick, did it? At my retirement party, a dear friend of mine, in fact, he's a county deputy, sang a song. And his song just reminded us that when we get to heaven, there'll be folks who will greet us and say, you know what? The reason I'm here is because you were there. See, the reason I'm in heaven now is because you were there for me. You shared the word. You told me about Jesus. You loved me into the kingdom. And that's why I'm here. And I've always thought that's part of the reward that we enjoy when we get to heaven. Is knowing that our lives were lived in such a way. And sometimes we don't even realize it. Sometimes you influence people that you don't even know you're influencing, and they come to Jesus because of you. Paul says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. Remember I told you that a while ago? The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. Now all of these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. You and I are God's plan A for reaching the world. And there is someone out there who is dependent upon you to be faithful to that ministry. Maybe a relative, maybe a neighbor, maybe a coworker, someone who's just waiting for someone to tell them about Jesus. And you may very well be that one. Paul concludes, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God were making an appeal through us, we beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. If you're here this morning and you're not a Christian, the most important thing you can hear me say is that if you simply open your heart in faith and say yes to Jesus Christ, I guarantee he will say yes to you. There is no doubt about that. You can have salvation, a relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. You can have assurance of your salvation, not based upon anything I would say, but based upon what Jesus said. You can begin that process of preparation for a heaven that's being prepared for you, and you can fulfill the purpose of provision. So living the Christian life abundantly starts as life in Christ. Salvation, assurance of our salvation, preparation, and provision. Let's pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, there's someone here this morning who needs life in Christ to become ever more real to them because they've not yet said yes to Jesus Christ, or because something has happened along the way in their journey that has discouraged them, made it difficult, or because they are just trying to find their way and you've brought them this way because they're seeking, and in their seeking, you have a plan for them. This may be the place. If it is, lay it upon their heart and lay it upon ours. Lord, in any way that we receive members, if they would come and join this body of Christ in this place, we bid them come in Jesus' name. Father, whatever your will is for each of us and all of us, may we affirm the Christian life that is ours because of Christ. And may we find in Christ the real meaning of abundance in that life. This we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me for just a moment and let us sing just a couple of verses. If there's a decision you feel you need to make, we bid you come in Jesus' name as we sing.
Take
a brief moment. That particular hymn always has special significance to me. It was on a Sunday night in 1961 that invitation was being sung. The pastor extended it, and I realized it was for me, and I surrendered the ministry that night. The reason I'm the pastor of First Baptist Church of Oakville is not because I was clever enough to worm my way into this position, or you were clever enough to invite me and persuade me to come. It's because of the chorus of that song. See, I'll follow my Christ who loves me so. Wherever he leads, I'll go. But I want you to know I couldn't be more thankful that he's led me here for this point in my life and in our church life. Isn't it? Brendan, I'll see you at the back, and let's see, you did the invocation, but you need to practice. Would you lead us in our bento?
Don't go anywhere.
Oh.
Brendan, come up here.
Oh.
Please indulge me for just a minute. Brendan, you come on up here. Don't worry, you're not going to get anything bad, and you're not going to get any money either. That's, okay. Neither one's going to happen. I mean, you're not going to get anything special. Some of you may know about this, but I'm guessing that most of you don't, but I just want to make sure that you as a congregation do know about this, because I think it's very special. And the reason I have Brenda up here is because, of course, they're a team, just like you and your wife are a team. You know what I mean? I want to read you something, just to make sure I didn't take very long what I have to say. Our pastor, Pastor John, has been selected as chairperson of the Ministry Support Committee of the Missouri Baptist Convention. This means he's now one of only 9 members of the Administrative Committee of the Executive Board of the Missouri Baptist Convention, which includes the other chairpersons of committee, the treasurer, secretary, vice president, and president of the Missouri Baptist Convention, one of only 9. This is a position of great trust to which our pastor here at First Baptist Church of Oakville has been selected. So I'd like to ask you to join me in congratulating our pastor and Brenda. Thank you.
I didn't know that was coming. I thought Ed had an announcement to make this morning. I would ask you only to pray for me that as I have this opportunity to serve the Lord and Missouri Baptist, that I will represent First Baptist Church of Oakville in a way that will make you proud. I'm grateful, not just for myself or Brenda, but for our church family, that we can have this involvement in God's kingdom work in Missouri. So thank you, Ed, and thank you very, very much. It means a great deal. God bless you. And I'm serious. Would you then lead us in our benediction?
Well, after I get your autograph. Oh, well,
as our deacon.
Rhonda has some.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay,
surprise.
I beg you.
No, I'm kidding. Oh, I'm kidding.
Give her the mic.
This is not nearly as awesome as that was. It's getting that time of year again when we've got to get set up for the Easter egg hunt. So every year the church has an Easter egg hunt for the kids. And what we need from you is candy, preferably not peanuts or chocolate, because if it is outside, that melts, and that was an awkward year. So if you will, we'll just start kind of putting those announcements out, but I wanted to make you aware of it, okay?
Thanks, Rhonda. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we've been blessed and privileged again to be in your house today. Thank you for what you've done for us and what you are doing for us and what you continue to do for us. Bless this congregation out in our community. Bless this church in your service in this community. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.